All right, here we go. This is the sequel you've all been waiting for because we lost the 21. And where did it go? So last time I was telling you about this, well, we formed some hypotheses and then we used this example to disprove them. Well, it was also the very obvious counterexample of just adding a sequence to itself, but that was obviously not what we wanted to be doing. But in this case, we were adding something, we got a perfectly nice sequence of period 21. And then when we just looked at the second offset, suddenly we got a period 7 rather than 21. And we would have expected to see 4 21s. And well, if you check the other offset, you're getting another period 21. And if you add the all zero sequence, you're also getting 21. But that's just 3 21s. So what happened with the 4? The title of this section is Math versus Mystery, so word of warning, there will be a bit of math, more than normal, but at the end we will resolve our mystery completely and we'll understand everything we've been seeing so far. So at least there's some good goal at the end. So let's introduce some notation. So we're all going to be dealing with L of SRs in this case, and we're always going to fix state sizes n, and we're going to take p as a characteristic polynomial. We will need a property of polynomials that you can compute what is called the reciprocal, which means you're taking the polynomial that you have, you identify the degree, in this case it's n, so that's the largest coefficient that appears, and then you multiply by x to the n and you change the exponent from the x to the I to x to the minus I. Now the resulting thing is still a polynomial because the largest exponent was n. And so we now have minus n, and then n minus n is 0, so it's not going to be negative. But we're changing the order, basically. So we're taking the polynomial with the highest coefficient here, lowest coefficient there, and flip them around so that the powers of x are now matching on the other side. So that's the reciprocal of a polynomial. To see an example, well, here's the default examples. If you're taking the x to the n plus 1, degree is n, so we multiply by x to the n and change from x to the n to x to the n to the x to the minus n. So then those two cancel out, we're getting 1 for that, and then we're getting a term x to the n. So for this particular polynomial, it is equal to its reciprocal. Also, if you do this twice, well, it just means you're changing the order, you're flipping this way and you're flipping back. So obviously, you're getting the polynomial back after doing it twice. And the other thing which we're going to be using throughout this lecture is a generating function. So if you're given a sequence, then the sequence runs from I equals 0 till infinity. And we're now introducing a power series that belongs to it, which just takes the si and multiplies by x to the I. So the sequence, this generating function, does depend on the starting state. So for instance, if you have the all zero sequence, this will be just the all zero power series. And then if you have a fixed L of SR, you're going to get 2 to the n different generating functions. However, we're going to focus on the common properties that exist independent of the state. So whenever you see an S, well, it has some starting state, but we're trying to keep it generic. And this is already the starting point of our helpful results. So if you're taking this S of x, which has infinite degree, so x goes to all the powers, and we multiply by the reciprocal of the characteristic polynomial, so a finite thing times this infinite thing, then you're getting something with a degree is less than n. So definitely finite degree, and even less than the degree of p, because p, remember, the characteristic polynomial has also degree n if the LFSR has state size n. Well, it's a claim, so we have to prove it. So let's jump right in. Well, let's do one step back because I didn't highlight this. When I was writing this reciprocal, here I'm just doing the normal definition. I'm moving the n in there, but I can of course also change how I enumerate those. So here I'm just, instead of starting from fi from the bottom going to x on the top, here I'm going with fn minus 1, so starting with the highest number for f and going down to 0. So it's basically changing from a for loop counting 2, and it's a down 2. And so when I'm now jumping in here, I'm already applying, so here's the catch the polynomial, I'm applying the reciprocal, and I'm using the second formulation, so I have the cn minus 1, n minus I, x to the I. I'm only doing this in order to make the next step a little bit easier, because I want to sort these by powers. I will also simplify my life a little bit by not considering this one separately there, so I'll just introduce an extra coefficient. Well, I'm normally running from I equals 0 to I minus 1 with the CIs, and now I'm introducing a top coefficient, CN, which is 1. So that matches the, well, here it's 1 times x to the 0, and normally it's 1 times x to the n. Okay, so then let's multiply those things out. I will collect things by power of x. So I will have something times x to the 0, something times x to the 1. Now for x to the 0, that means I'm just multiplying the two constants. So that is just, well, I'm getting x to the 0 for I equals 0, so I just have cn there, and the other one is an s0. Now for x to the 1, I'll have two combinations. I'll have an x to the 1 from the s side or from the c side. And then I'm going up slowly, getting larger and larger powers, but until I had hit n, it won't be the full length. So I will actually split my result into these two parts. I'm doing the first part where it is up to n minus 1, where I'm having only sums up to I. And afterwards, well, I will always sum up the full length. I'm getting contribution from both of those parties, from both of these parts, and that is starting at n and going to infinity. And then it's just sorting, so I'm having this one count up, this one count down. Then it is the cn minus j, that's the normal counting up. And then this one is counting down, so it's taking I minus j. So these are the coefficients that fits into x to the I. And then we sum them up, starting from the, well, lowest part, c equals 0, till j equals 0 till j equals I. And then over here, well, we have an offset of n, which is, well, starting here, and then all of them run until they reach n. Now the claim is that all of this here goes away, so that we're only left with the first part, so that everything on the right hand side is 0, and, well, the other one is a degree less than n, so it goes up to n minus 1. So we don't need to bother with this. Maybe there's some cancellation, maybe not. But what's important to show is that there are cancellations on the right. So let's look at, well, the definition of the LFSR. So that was that we have a feedback sequence, so that we're defining the, well, k plus nth step in terms of the k plus 1, k plus 2, till k to the k plus n minus 1 steps with those shift coefficients. So remember that those were the, well, 0 or not 0, 1 or not 1 above the registers. And I'm going to again use the cn equals 1 notation. So I'm bringing the sk plus n over to the other side with a coefficient of 1, well, also known as cn. And so I now have the sequence 0 equals, well, j equals 0 till n, cj, sj, and then, well, for every iterations, so the sj gets a k plus. Last step, I will change the order of summation. This is like what we've just been doing when I introduced the reciprocal. Namely, instead of running from j up to n, I'll be running with the powers down. So it's still 0, but I'm now changing these to n minus j, and here also n minus j instead of j. And this looks pretty familiar already, right? So let's look up here. There is a cn minus j, and there is a, okay, it's a s sub I minus j. Well, what I know about this I is that it's at least n, n goes to infinity. So I'll just rename my k plus n to be I. Well, k is larger than 0, or larger or equal to 0. N, that gives me the offset n, so that is a valid I here. And then those two expressions where the blue arrows go, those are actually identical. And, well, it says zero. So what I'm doing here is I have the first part, and then I have this infinitely long sum, but it's only zero times x to the I. And that gives the proof that we're looking for, namely, we're only looking at this first part, and that has degree at most n minus 1. Okay, wasn't so bad. So that's what generating functions are good for. It also helps us to give a second characterization of the characteristic polynomials, namely, if you have a polynomial p of x, well, which has this form, so the important parts is that the leading term x to the n has coefficient 1, and there's a constant term of 1. Remember that I said that the last coefficient from the feedback shift register must be 1, else we could have done one shorter. Then, for some f of x here of degree less than n, that is a generating function of some LFSR where the state size n satisfies, well, with the state size of n, and this LFSR is defined by exactly this property. And the starting state depends on what is an f. So running through f, running through the disembodied possibilities there of degree less than n, means, well, it's a binary polynomial, degree is less than n, so we're having 2 to the n different polynomials there. So that also corresponds to getting all the different starting states. And then when you run through this proof, so you now want to show that this one is the characteristic polynomial of such a sequence, then you're again computing p times s of x, so you multiply by p, the reciprocal of p, and then the requirement that the degree of f is less than n, that just means that you have the same cancellations as before, and then just as on the previous page down here, it means that the sj satisfier equation, recurrence relation with these coefficients that are fixed by the p of x. So that means we're getting another definition of the characteristic polynomial. So if we have that the sequence, or the generating function of the sequence, is equal to something over polynomial, where this something is of degree less than this polynomial, then that is the characteristic polynomial of the generating function, or of the LFSR that led to this generating function. Well, I promised you some proofs. Now, it's still not the mystery solved. This is a different proof. Namely, I promised you two sets ago that we could prove that if you have a polynomial, which is a characteristic polynomial, which is irreducible, but not full order, so if you don't get the 2 to the n minus 1 as the order, then still all non-zero starting states have the same sequence length. So that means we did this example then that we had only order 5, and then we concluded that the 2 to the 4th or 16th state split into 5, 5, 5, and 1, but we haven't proved that yet. Okay, so let's assume that there is some period R. Well, it must have some period, and let's call this R. And we also know that if the polynomial, well, the degree, well, the order of this polynomial is L, which is the same as the order of the state update matrix, then we know that any period will divide that order. So we know that this R, whatever it is a divisor of L. So when you're looking at this generating function, there's only anything interesting up to R. Afterwards, it repeats. So let's call this thing S bar and just take the first R coefficients. That is the interesting part, and afterwards it repeats. That means, well, we're just getting the x to the R fold of this, and then the x to the 2R fold of this. And so I can write my generating function as a product of this S bar times 1 x to the r, x to the 2r, x to the 3r, etc. Now I need to appeal from something to something which is a little while back for you, namely calculus. There you have seen a power series as well, and you have seen that when you write out the Taylor expansion of 1 over x to the r plus 1, or in general 1 over something plus 1, then that's the the sum of the something to the j, summing over these j's. So what is in this parenthesis here is actually a short expression. It's just 1 over x to the r plus 1. So we combine this with the previous lemma where we have that the generating function is equal, well, there's some polynomial of degree less than n, that's called the f of x, divided by the reciprocal of p, the characteristic polynomial. And now we have another way of writing it, starting from this equation here, and we're getting that s is also equal to x bar divided by x to the r plus 1. What we're going to do now is sort things around. We're going to shift the order, we rearrange, and we compute the reciprocals. Along the way, we're going to remember our example because we proved just a moment ago that when you're taking x to the r plus 1, compute the reciprocal, it's its own reciprocal. So that doesn't change anything. All right, what I've been doing here, I'm taking the x to the r plus 1, moving it over to the left. I'm taking the reciprocal of p, moving it over to the right. And then I'm computing reciprocals every which way. So p, reciprocal, reciprocal gets p again. The f and the s bar gets reciprocals for the first time. And then the x to the r plus 1 doesn't have a reciprocal anymore. And now let's check the degrees. And here we have an equality, which definitely holds. And if you look at the degrees, then on the left-hand side, we have something of degree less than n times x to the r plus 1. On the right-hand side, we have this s bar of x, or the reciprocal of it. And then p of x is an irreducible of degree n. Now, irreducible polynomials behave mostly like prime numbers. So if an irreducible polynomial divides the product of two polynomials, then must divide one of the factors. Now in this case, p has degree n, so it cannot divide f star. So that means it must be a divisor of x to the r plus 1. And then the definition of order was that the order of p is the smallest power of x, so that x to that power is congruent to 1 mod p of x. So here, we're getting that the order of p, well, we don't get that it's equal to r, we get that it's a divisor of r. We definitely know that when you take x to the r, it's equal to 1, but it could be the same as in normal periods, it could be a divisor of it. Huh. But now we have two statements. We have on the top that x that r divides l, and we've just shown that l divides r. So if you combine these two, then we're actually getting that r is equal to l. And that was a claim in the lemma. Namely, if you have a non-zero starting state, then we're getting the same period L that any of the sequences has. So we've now proven what we showed, well, by an example, where we had the 5, 5, 5, 1. So in any case, if you have an irreducible polynomial of order L, then all non-zero starting states give you a sequence of period L. And the zero starting state gives you a period of 1. And so that solves the whole situation for irreducible polynomials. That leaves a lot still. We still have a lot of mysteries. And to get closer to the mystery, we want to now look at sums of LFSRs. So the mystery appeared when we took two LFSRs and added them up. So here's the theorem which we'll now prove. If you take two such sequences, and they come from LFSRs with characteristic polynomials, let's call them P and Q, and so now for the one time I'm deviating from saying characteristic polynomial is always P, well, the characteristic polynomial belonging to S is always P, and now I'm introducing a new sequence, Ti, which has characteristic polynomial Q, and that one will have some state length M. Now the theorem claims that there exists a single LFSR which matches the output of the sum of these two sequences, and that we actually know something about its characteristic polynomial, namely that it's equal to the LCM of these two input polynomials. So you're looking at the polynomials from these two input sequences, and then the characteristic polynomial of the sum of those is just the LCM of those two characteristic polynomials. Well, we have one tool. As I say, if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail, so let's use our generating functions. So the sequence, or this lecture, is really generating functions are useful. So here we look at the generating function of the sum, and obviously we can split this up into s of x plus t of x. And then we know that there exists some polynomials f of x and g of x, f of x of degree less than n, g of x of degree less than m, so that the s of x is that fraction and the t of x is the other fraction. We don't really know anything about these fractions, but we want to bring them on the same denominator. And you learned about the LCM back at school exactly when you computed fractions, namely the denominator of a fraction is the LCM of the denominators. And the same is true also for polynomials. So here we're having that the when we sum those up, we have to bring them on the same denominator, so we take the LCM of these two, and then we have to multiply by some polynomials to make this work. So I'm introducing a polynomial a of x, so that a of x is what we need to extend the numerator to in order to get an LCM in the first denominator, and a b of x for the second denominator. And so then when we call this bottom thing, we call it R. Now, I already showed some features of reciprocals, and another feature that I'm going to use here is that if you apply the reciprocal to an LCM, then you can actually move it inside. So the reciprocal of the LCM is the LCM of the reciprocals. That is because polynomials, when you multiply by the x to the n and change the x to the I to x to the minus I, their divisors are matching. Okay, so we now have a very familiar expression here. We have a reciprocal of a polynomial down there, and we have some other polynomial up there. And we can say something about the degrees there, namely the degree of this whole thing, the numerator, is less than the degree of R. Because, well, what we know about A is that we have to multiply P star of X to get R star. And so the A times F is less than the degree of A times P, which is the degree of R. And similarly for the B times Q and the B times G. So this expression numerator has degree less than the bottom. And now we can invoke this other characterization of characteristic polynomial to say that this is actually a characteristic polynomial of a sequence which has exactly the, well, state length, whatever this polynomial R of X has as its degree. One important thing here, this is not just for a specific state, we did everything independent of what these S, I, and T I actually are, so it's not dependent on the starting state. It's not just for the zero sequence or anything like that. And that is now actually enough to solve our mystery. So let's take a look at what we have here. What are these characteristic polynomials for these two LFSRs? So the second one, that's the x squared plus x plus 1, which we've been doing a lot in the last lecture. That one was irreducible of degree 2, has order 3, and so that's one of the nice maximal LFSRs. And with the other one, I was kind of fooling you by saying, hey, look, it's an x to the 5 plus x plus 1. We have seen x to the cube plus x plus 1 being irreducible, x to the 4 plus x plus 1. This is just the same shape. But actually, this one is not irreducible. So when you look at this one, you can factor it as a product. And yeah, of course, that's where the x squared plus x plus 1 comes in. So the top LFSR is actually a combination of two LFSRs and one of which is matching the one which I'm just adding. So of course we'll see cancellations. Of course it doesn't give us anything better than just the top LFSR. So when you look at the LCM, now that we've proven it, the LCM is just the same as what the top LFSR has anyway. So this would really be nothing you want to use in reality. So when somebody gives you a toolbox with little LFSRs and suggests that you can build yourself a big LFSR from those, you must ensure that the ones you're picking are co-prime. Ideally, you want to pick them, each of them irreducible, maximum length, but at the very least, you want a co-prime. So we're actually not missing a fourth 21. It's not that we can find one. Actually, there's only one 21. It's like a Highlander, there can only be one, you know? So when you had, if you had done this whole sequence, if you had actually sat down and calculated the third shift, the one which you're getting from starting state 1-0 on the second LFSR, you would have gotten a shift of the one which we had on the screen. And easier, you could actually go back to the starting slide and see that the LFSR, which is written there, is a shift of the top one. So we didn't gain anything by looking at offsets of the bottom one. That just meant we are shifting this one. So there's only one sequence of period 21 coming out of this. And then we have seen a period of length 7. There's, of course, a period of length 3 from just the second LFSR. And there's a period of length 1, namely the all zero sequence. So that sums up to what we now know is the right number, namely 2 to the 5, because the combination is matching a single LFSR with a state of length 5. So there are no 4, no 3, there's just the single period 21 and then the smaller ones. So if you want to analyze an LFSR, then you would be looking, so if it's given as a single polynomial, you would be factoring the irreducible the characteristic polynomial, or if you're giving sums of those, you do this for each of the summons. And then you're writing them as powers of irreducible polynomials such that the polynomials are different. So everything for the fi you put into the power of fi. So if you're seeing an x squared plus x plus 1, you're putting them all together, you multiply them, you have the exponent which is at least 1 there, and then you move over to the next one. So fi is not the same as fj. We have seen from the sum of the two identical polynomials, well, LFSRs, that we don't understand really how to compute a single thing. So like f to the fi to the ei is not ei copies of fi. That would be far less. So we actually, if you're getting fi to the ei, that can have a larger period than a single of those, and typically does. So we need to compute those orders separately, and then we can combine periods, take care of offsets to get all periods. And now, because these polynomials are coprime, there are no more cancellations. So when I was asking to do calculations on sheet 2, I was purposefully giving you kind of a wrong step 2 to show you something which would look like a hypothesis. And that was what I've now summarized as our first hypothesis, and then get you into a corner where this doesn't work with LFSR in part F. So now that you know all of these things, you can go and revisit the LFSR in part F. And then I've summarized the correct hypothesis. This is just the same slide that I had in the previous set, with the only difference that there's now on top a line saying that the LFSRs must have co-prime characteristic polynomials. All right, that's it for today. Thank you for your attention.